A very good morning to all of you. In today's session, we shall be discussing the first part of anti-Parkinsonian drugs. So by the end of this topic, you should be able to classify anti-Parkinsonian drugs and you should be able to describe the pharmacology of the main drug, that is levodopa. So we shall be starting with the introduction to this topic. So Parkinsonism, it is an extrapyramidal motor disorder. So the main cause or the most important cause of Parkinsonism is the Parkinson's disease. It is so called because it was first described by James Parkinson in 1817 and he had termed it as the paralysis agitans or the shaking palsy. It is a progressive degenerative disorder which usually affects the elderly. And most of the cases of Parkinson's disease are idiopathic. So this is the main cause of Parkinsonism. Then there's another cause of Parkinsonism, that is the drug-induced Parkinsonism. And it is caused usually by drugs like neuroleptics, metoclopramide, and etc. And this is a reversible type of Parkinsonism, which gets reversed once the drug is stopped. So why I have elaborated on this is because most of the times you don't understand the difference between Parkinsonism and the Parkinson's disease. So Parkinsonism is a motor disorder and one of the causes of Parkinsonism is Parkinson's disease and the other important cause which is nowadays increasing in number is the drug-induced Parkinsonism. And in the exam also, you can be asked about the management or the drugs for Parkinson's disease or the drugs for drug-induced Parkinsonism. And the drugs will be different for both the cases, as you will be seeing as we go further into the topic. So at this point, just remember, Parkinsonism is an extrapyramidal motor disorder, and there are mainly two causes. That is, one is Parkinson's disease, which affects the elderly, and the other one is the reversible drug-induced Parkinsonism. Now, what are the features or the symptoms of Parkinson's disease? The symptoms are primary symptoms like rigidity, tremor, hypokinesia. Secondary symptoms include a defective posture and a gait, a mask-like facies, sialorrhea, and dementia. If the patient is untreated, then the symptoms can progress over several years and it can end up in lead to an end-stage disease, which is characterized by very severe rigidity. The patient is unable to move, the patient is unable to breathe properly, and death can result mainly due to chest infections and embolism. So again, I have listed all of the features in this form, that is pill rolling tremors. So the characteristic tremors are pill rolling tremors. Then you have got hypokinesias or bradykinesias, which include ikinesia, bradykinesia, akathisia, and all. You can see here the pill rolling tremor and the posture, the gait, everything is different. It's a very short, pestilent type of gait. And there is no arm swinging. Patient can have sialorrhea. Patient can have oculogyric crisis. That is a vertical, constant vertical gaze, bilateral vertical gaze. That is called as an oculogyric crisis. So the details of these symptomology and the disease as such, obviously you'll be learning in the in your coming years under the Department of Medicine. So I'm just mentioning to you the relevant features which will help you to identify a case of Parkinson's disease or Parkinsonism if you are given that in a case history. So now this is a characteristic handwriting of a Parkinsonism patient. You can see there is a trailing of the handwriting. So you can see at the towards the end there's a trail. It's called the trailing handwriting of the patient with Parkinson's disease. Now we look into the pathogenesis of Parkinson's disease. So first, before we go into the pathogenesis, we should just understand the normal control of voluntary movements. Now, this will look a little bit difficult for you. And this is the same figure I have taken from your reference textbook. But I'll not be explaining very elaborately because I'm quite sure that it will confuse you more. But I'll try to make it a little simple. for you. So we should understand that the normal control of voluntary movements is by the key play of certain areas. That is, first is the motor cortex that you know already, which sends the sensory information for the movement. Then the main area is this striatum. You can see here, striatum is mainly having this GABAergic neurons. This striatum is the one which mainly controls and coordinates the voluntary movements. And then you have got the basal ganglia, which is consisting of the substantia nigra and globus pallidus. And this basal ganglia, it produces a feedback to the motor cortex through the thalamus. And this feedback is actually responsible for smoothening out the voluntary movements. So the motor cortex is the one which initiates the sensory info, and the striatum is there, which is actually coordinating and controlling the movement. And the function of the basal ganglia is to smoothen out the voluntary movement. So when the voluntary movements that we have, they are very smoothened out. We don't have a more or less of the movements. Okay, this is because it is being smoothened out by the basal ganglia through a feedback to the motor cortex through the thalamus. Now let us look at what is the, at this point you should also remember that glutamate is an excitatory neurotransmitter and GABA is an inhibitory neurotransmitter. All this you should have covered in your introduction to neurotransmitters that was taken up for you previously. So you can see here the striatum, it receives the sensory info through the glutamatergic neuron, which is excitatory in nature. It also gets the input, that is the dopaminergic neuronic information from the substantia nigra pars compactor. You can see this is a dopaminergic relay that is coming from the substantia nigra pars compactor, and this is the glutamatergic relay that is coming to the striatum. Now you can see the output, and you also see some interlinks of the acetylcholinergic neurons, which are actually balancing both the relays. Now we can see here there are the outputs from the striatum to the basal ganglia. You can see two pathways. Here there are two pathways. One is direct pathway and the other one is the indirect pathway. Direct pathway, you can see there is only one GABAergic connection, whereas in the indirect pathway, you can see two GABAergic connection and one glutamatergic connection. Okay, this is the two pathways to the output pathways from the striatum to the basal ganglia. Now, usually what happens is that the dopaminergic action on both these pathways is inhibitory. You only remember that much. That is, a dopaminergic action on both these pathways, output pathways from the striatum to the basal ganglia, is inhibitory. So what will happen? What happens as a result? The GABAergic transmission, the GABAergic outflow, you can see here, the GABAergic outflow will be inhibited in a normal way. So the feedback to the thalamus will be inhibited, and then you can see the feedback from to the cortex from the basal ganglia is having a GABAergic connection, and it is having an excitatory glutamatergic connection. So the dopaminergic action is inhibitory, and so it is somewhat reducing the GABAergic action on the thalamus. That is, GABA is an inhibitory neurotransmitter. So the GABA action is decreased, means the inhibition on the thalamus will be decreased. Okay, so the idea is that this basal ganglia is mainly smoothening out the voluntary movements. Okay, now in case of Parkinson's disease, what is happening? There is a progressive degeneration of the dopaminergic neurons in the substantia nigra. As a result, what happens? That inhibitory control or the inhibitory output on the basal ganglionic GABAergic neurons is decreased. As a result, what happens? Now more GABA is available. Now more GABA will be available, so it will start inhibiting the thalamus. And as a result, the excitatory the connections from the thalamus also inhibited. That is why we get a decreased movements, hypokinesias, in the case of Parkinson's disease. Also, you should remember that dopaminergic action on the cholinergic receptors or the cholinergic neurons is actually inhibitory. The cholinergic neurons are excitatory. In this case, when the dopamine levels are going down, even the cholinergic appears to be relatively high. And so these imbalances that have occurred will result in abnormal movements in the case of Parkinson's disease. Now, this is appearing a little bit complicated. At your level, what you can see simply is that in Parkinson's disease, there is a progressive degeneration of dopaminergic neurons from the substantia nigra pars compacta. This will cause a deficiency of dopamine in the striatum. This will result in a imbalance between dopaminergic, that is the inhibitory system, and the cholinergic, that is the excitatory system in the striatum, which gives rise to motor defect. At the undergraduate level, this much is enough. This slide is enough. If you're having difficulty in understanding the complete circuits that I have described earlier, only this much will be enough for you to understand the chapter and to go further. Now, just remember, there's an imbalance between the dopaminergic inhibitory system and the cholinergic excitatory system. So mainly the dopaminergic system is getting affected here. Okay, dopaminergic system is coming down, and because of that, the cholinergic system appears to be relatively higher. It is not the cholinergic system which is directly affected. Because the dopaminergic system has become less, the cholinergic system appears to be relatively more active than the dopaminergic system. So what will be the aim of therapy of Parkinson's disease, or what will be the aim of therapy? That is, we should be aiming at increasing the dopaminergic activity in the brain. That is a primary aim. And the secondary aim is to decrease the cholinergic activity, which is appearing to be relatively high. These are the main aims of our therapy. So whenever we see the drugs, we will see either of these. That is, either we are increasing the dopaminergic activity by some drugs, or we are decreasing the cholinergic activity by using drugs. So we have talked a lot about dopamine, okay? So, and we'll be talking more about dopamine. So it is better that we recap about dopamine a little more before we actually go into the topic in general. So this dopamine, I think you should have covered in your introduction to CNS transmitters, and also you have covered a little bit of it in the when you were studying about adrenergic system. So we'll just go very fast with the synthesis and the metabolism of dopamine. So dopamine is synthesized from the tyrosine by tyrosine hydroxylase. It is getting converted to DOPA. It is getting converted to dopamine by the DOPA decarboxylase. Dopamine is stored in the vesicles, and when the nerve impulse reaches the nerve terminal, dopamine is released and it starts acting on the receptors present on the postsynaptic terminal. And once the dopamine action is over, the excess of the dopamine is taken back into the nerve terminal by specific transporters. Dopamine is metabolized by mainly two enzymes, that is catechol O-methyl transferase and monoamine oxidase B. There's another subtype, that is A, but B is oxidizing or metabolizing dopamine in particular. So in periphery, mainly the metabolism is by the catechol O-methyl transferase enzyme, but in the brain, the dopamine is metabolized by both catechol O-methyl transferase and monoamine oxidase B enzyme. Monoamine oxidase B is more present inside the brain than in the periphery. The product of metabolism of dopamine by these enzymes is homovanillic acid. Now we'll go to the classification of drugs. So the first class of drugs includes the drugs which are affecting or increasing the brain dopaminergic activity. This includes a dopamine precursor, that is levodopa, peripheral decarboxylase inhibitors, that is carbidopa, benzeracide. I told you the carboxylase enzyme, it converts the levodopa to dopamine. So this is an inhibitor of that. We will see the actions of these drugs later on. Then we have got dopaminergic agonists like bromocriptine, ropinirole, pramipexole, MAOB inhibitors, seligiline, rasagiline, COMT inhibitors, entacapone, tolcapone, dopamine facilitators or NMDA receptor agonists, amantadine. This is the first class of drugs. Then we have got the second class of drugs which decrease the cholinergic activity in the brain. These are the central anticholinergic drugs, that is trihexyphenidyl, procyclidine, bipyridine, and antihistaminics, that is orphenadrine and promethazine. So by the next class, you should be learning this classification by heart. Now we'll go to the first drug of this used for treating Parkinsonism, that is levodopa. It is the dopamine precursor. You are very familiar with this drug because you have been quoting this drug as an example of prodrug right from the time you have joined in pharmacology. So this is a prodrug. It is inactive by itself, but it is converted into the dopamine inside the body. Now the question appears that why are we giving a dopamine precursor? Why not give the dopamine itself as a therapy for Parkinsonism? This is because the site of action of dopamine should be in the brain in the case of Parkinson's disease. But you all know dopamine cannot cross the blood-brain barrier. Hence, we have to give it in the form of levodopa, which can cross the blood-brain barrier. Now, what happens to the, once we take the levodopa, when we take the orally, levodopa is taken, 95% of the oral dose is metabolized in the peripheral tissues, that is mainly in the gut and the liver, by the enzyme dopa decarboxylase to dopamine. A part of it is also metabolized by COMT, that is levodopa is also metabolized by COMT to 3-O-methyldopa. Now the dopamine which is formed in the periphery by the metabolism with the help of decarboxylase enzyme, it will act on the peripheral organs and produce the action of dopamine in the periphery. So far we have no action in the CNS. Only 1-2% of the administered levodopa crosses the blood-brain barrier, where it is taken up by the surviving dopaminergic neurons. So you have to remember very carefully, there are only less number of dopaminergic neurons are there in the Parkinson's disease because most have degenerated. And these neurons, they have to take up the levodopa, and inside these neurons, the levodopa has to be decarboxylated to dopamine, which will be stored and released as transmitter. This is very important. These neurons have to take up the levodopa and metabolize or convert it into the dopamine by decarboxylation to dopamine, which is stored and then released as transmitter. Now we'll see what are the actions. So we see that the actions, so 95% of which it is metabolized in the periphery will produce peripheral actions, and the 1-2% which entered the brain, that is converted to dopamine and it will produce the CNS action. So we mainly want the CNS actions in the Parkinson's disease. So in the CNS, in the case in CNS, the response or the actions of the dopamine is referred to as the general alerting response. This is because you have already seen how a Parkinson's patient is. He's very hypokinetic. He is very immobile, very slow. So when you give this levodopa, it is like a general alerting response. It improves the hypokinesia and the rigidity first, and then it improves the tremor, and then only the secondary symptoms like the gait and the posture and all will be improved in time. There is no improvement in dementia. That is one point to be noted. There is no improvement in dementia with levodopa. However, in some patients, this progression, that is this improvement actually can progress to excitement and unwanted psychosis also. Now, this is the main action that is wanted in case of Parkinson's disease. It is a CNS action. Now, because of the peripheral action, I told you it is acting also in the periphery. It can act on the CVS. On the CVS, it causes tachycardia. Tachycardia, dopamine can act on receptors, which are mainly the dopaminergic receptors, D1, D2, D3, D4, and D5. And also it can act on adrenergic receptors, alpha and beta. We have discussed this long time back in the chapter on ANS. Okay, so tachycardia by dopamine is mainly because of stimulation of beta-1 receptors on the heart. It causes hypotension, that is postural hypotension. Now, this is mainly because, it could have caused hypertension or rise in BP because of its actions on adrenergic receptors in the blood vessels. But here, the hypotension is mainly because of its central action. The excess dopamine that is formed in the brain that decreases the sympathetic outflow and results in postural hypotension. And this is more commonly seen in patients who are taking antihypertensive drugs also. Now, it is one of the other peripheral actions is on the chemoreceptor trigger zone. You already know this is the main area which is involved in nausea and vomiting. The dopamine that is formed peripherally acts on the CTZ. Always remember, CTZ is a part of the brain, but it is not covered or it is not bound by the blood-brain barrier. Hence, it is coming under the peripheral action. So it is acting on the CTZ and it elicits the nausea and vomiting. So you can expect the side effect of the adverse drug reaction of levodopa as nausea and vomiting because it is acting on the CTZ. It is acting on the endocrine functions also. It inhibits the prolactin release and increases the growth hormone release. However, this is not a very significant thing that is usually seen in Parkinson's disease. But you can remember that it inhibits the prolactin release and increases the growth hormone release. It is more of theoretical than practical information. Now, once again, we can see it once again, the summary of whatever we have discussed so far. So you can see the levodopa. This is acting in the periphery. It is converted by dopa decarboxylase to dopamine and it is acting on the heart, on the blood vessel and on the, you can see on the CTZ receptors, which is causing nausea and vomiting. It is crossing the blood-brain barrier. Only 1-2% crosses the blood-brain barrier where it is taken up by the dopaminergic neurons, converted to dopamine by decarboxylase enzyme. Interacts with the D2 receptors and this is responsible for relieving the symptoms of Parkinsonism. Now we see the pharmacokinetics. So it is rapidly absorbed from the small intestine by active transport. The amino acids present in the food inhibits its absorption. So always levodopa should be given 1 hour before meal so that there is no interaction of the food with the its absorption. Also, there is gastric emptying is delayed. That is also one problem. Gastric emptying, if it is delayed, it is exposed to the decarboxylase enzyme in the gut for a long time. As a result, more will be metabolized. And hence, the bioavailability of levodopa will be less because more will be converted into the dopamine in the periphery itself. And we'll be having less availability of levodopa to cross the blood-brain barrier. So that is also one more significant point. Only 1-2%, which I told you, enters brain. Plasma T-half is 1-2 hours. The metabolic products, whether it is formed peripherally or centrally, is excreted in the urine. Now we look at the adverse effects of levodopa. So we'll divide this into two parts, that is the adverse effects which occur at the initiation of therapy and the adverse effects which occur after prolonged therapy. So at the initiation of the therapy, patient can have nausea and vomiting. But one thing is that tolerance will develop to this adverse effect after some time and the patient will not be having nausea and vomiting after some days of therapy. Then the patient can have postural hypotension. This is mainly seen in 1/3 of patients, especially those who are on antihypertensive drugs. In some, it can be just asymptomatic. In some people, it can produce dizziness and fainting. The tolerance develops to this adverse effect also after some time. Then, because of beta 1 action on the heart, it can cause cardiac arrhythmias, exacerbation of angina can also occur. This is more seen in patients who are having already some comorbidities like CAD and all. And another characteristic thing that is seen is taste disturbances. Okay, so you have seen taste disturbances in ACE inhibitors also, and you can have taste disturbances with the use of levodopa also. Now, after prolonged therapy, that is after many years of therapy, you can have abnormal movements, that is dyskinesias. So these involve facial tics, grimacing, trunk thrusting, choreoathetoid movements of the limbs. Okay, so choreoathetoid movement is like a dance-like movements of the limbs and all. Now, with treatment, like though the hypokinesia and all decrease, but these adverse effects, that is dyskinesias, become more troublesome. The patient can also develop behavioral effects, which can range from anxiety, nightmares, depression, hallucinations, mental confusion to even frank psychosis. And this is all because of the excessive presence of dopamine in the limbic system. You know, limbic system is the one that is controlling the emotions. So more excessive dopamine in the limbic system can cause this things, these emotions or these behavioral defects to happen. So we really want the dopamine levels to be more in the substantia nigra. But because so much of dopamine is present, it can reach the limbic system and can cause these unwanted behavioral effects. Now, another very important thing that is associated is fluctuation in the performance or the motor performance. So you have seen that in the initiation of therapy, you are having, the patient was having an improvement in the rigidity and in the hypokinesias. But now after 2 to 5 years, sometimes the level of control starts fluctuating. It can be either end of dose deterioration, that is a wearing off effect. And this is occurring mainly because of a fall in the plasma concentration that occurs towards the end of a dose interval. That is end of dose deterioration. That is occurring. It is occurring mainly because the plasma concentration of the levodopa is falling towards the end of the therapy. Other one is the on or off effect. This is very important. This is a fluctuation in response. That is, the patient is alternatively on or off. What is this on and what is this off? So on means that's relief of symptoms. And off means the patient is not having any kind of beneficial effect. Now, this on-off phenomena also, during the on phase also, there is a problem that the patient can have dyskinesias. That is occurring, I told you, as an adverse effect. So even the on phase is not a very favorable phase in such a patient. Okay, so in the on phase, the patient is not having hypokinesia, he will rather have some kind of abnormal dyskinesias. And in the off phase, obviously, he is having no benefit from the therapy. Now, the presence of on or off effect, this indicates that the disease is deteriorating or disease is progressing. Now, why is it so? This is because after some time, there is further degeneration of dopamine neurons. And I told you, levodopa has to be taken up by the neurons and converted to the dopamine. Now, because the there is degeneration that is going on increasing. What happens is that the neurons cannot restore and release the dopamine as before. Now, there is only the striatum is now synthesizing dopamine in a very moment-to-moment basis, which results in unpredictable fluctuations. That is, sometimes there is an improvement, sometimes there is not an improvement. So what can we do at this point? We can just fractionate the dose, and frequent administration may minimize the fluctuation in sometime. It is very difficult to treat this on-off phenomena. One strategy is to fractionate the dose and to give it more frequently. Now, the levodopa has to be used cautiously in elderly, in ischemic heart disease, cerebrovascular disease patients, peptic ulcer patients, psychiatric patients, hepatic and renal diseases, glaucoma and gout. These are very special cases where the use of levodopa has to be very cautious. Now we look at some of the drug interactions of levodopa. So pyridoxine, it abolishes the effect of levodopa by increasing the peripheral degradation of levodopa. Then there are some drugs that is mainly antipsychotic drugs like phenothiazines and butyrophenones, and anti-emetic drug like metoclopramide. They are all blocking the D2 receptors. So they can reverse the effect of levodopa. Levodopa, once it is converting to the dopamine in the brain, it is acting on the D2 receptors. I already told you. Now these drugs block these receptors and can then decrease the effect of levodopa. Now one important thing here, that is domperidone. This is a drug that you have studied in the under the anti-emetic drug, and we told you that levodopa produces nausea and vomiting. So how can you control the nausea and vomiting of levodopa? Can you give domperidone or can you give metoclopramide? So I already told you, metoclopramide will be, if you give metoclopramide, it will block the D2 receptors on the CTZ, as well as it will block these D2 receptors in the brain. So the even therapeutic effect will be lost if you are using metoclopramide. On the other hand, domperidone, it blocks the D2 receptors on the CTZ, which is outside the blood-brain barrier. Domperidone doesn't cross the blood-brain barrier, and hence it will not block the D2 receptors in the brain. Hence the therapeutic effects will not be compromised. Therapeutic effects of levodopa will not be compromised by domperidone. This is very important. It can be asked in the exam, choose between domperidone and metoclopramide for levodopa-induced vomiting. So you will choose domperidone. Reason, Metoclopramide can cross the blood-brain barrier. It can cross the blood-brain barrier and can block the D2 receptors in brain. Hence, it can compromise or it can decrease the therapeutic effect of levodopa. Domperidone doesn't cross the blood-brain barrier. It blocks the D2 receptors on the CTZ, which is outside the blood-brain barrier, and inhibits the nausea and vomiting. So once again, metoclopramide will block the D2 receptors on the CTZ, and it will also cross the blood-brain barrier and inhibit the therapeutic effect of levodopa. So metoclopramide is not used for levodopa-induced nausea and vomiting. Now, non-selective MAO inhibitors, they prevent the degradation of the dopamine produced by metabolism of levodopa, and this can lead to hypertensive crisis. Antihypertensive drugs, which when we are giving it with levodopa, can enhance the postural hypotension caused by levodopa. Atropine and anticholinergic drugs, they will retard the absorption of the levodopa from the gut, and hence more time will be available for its peripheral degradation, and hence the efficacy of levodopa may be reduced. So with that, we finish the class for today. So I want you all to revise this part and also write this in your notes. If you have any doubts, you can contact me personally. Thank you.